Hey, and welcome to the Shared Shelf Fiction Book Club at the Allen Public Library. I'm Abby. Once again, Kristen and I are happy to welcome Marzia to help us discuss our latest book club title, Dial A for Aunties by Jesse Q. Sutanto.
Hello, and I'm Kristen. Yes, we are all excited to share this author's hysterical most recent title with you. Here's a synopsis from the publisher. What happens when you mix one accident murder with 2,000 wedding guests and then toss in a possible curse on three generations of an immigrant Chinese Indonesian family? You get four meddling Asian aunties coming to the rescue. When Madeline Chan ends up accidentally killing her blind date, her meddlesome mother calls for her even more meddlesome aunties to help get rid of the body. Unfortunately, a dead body proves to be a lot more challenging to dispose of than one might anticipate, especially when it is accidentally shipped in a cake cooler to the over-the-top billionaire wedding that Meddy, her ma, and her aunties are working at an island resort on the California coastline. It is the biggest job yet for their family wedding business, and nothing, not even an unsavory corpse, will get in the way of her auntie's perfect buttercream cake flowers. But things go from inconvenient to downright torturous when Meddy's great college love and biggest heartbreak makes a surprise appearance amid the wedding chaos. Is it possible to escape murder charges, charm her ex back into her life, and pull off a stunning wedding all in one weekend?
Hello, I'm Marzia. I'm so glad to be back on Shared Shelf. I really enjoyed reading Dial A for Aunties. The book was hilarious and laugh out loud funny. There are so many moments in the book when I couldn't stop laughing. The book was also personally very relatable. I'm South Asian, so I completely relate to the idea of overbearing aunties all up in your business, who at the same time are fierce and strong and will do anything to protect you. I would like to read a quote from the book that immediately caught my eye. Jesse Q. Sutanto writes, "Everything in the Indo-Chinese culture is like that. Everybody is somehow related to everybody else, and deals happen because somebody's in-laws know someone else's friend's cousin." I picked this quote because I couldn't help but nod my head along, as I could totally see how this happens all the time in my community as well. The book is obviously more than just an accidental murder story. One of my favorite things about the book was the intergenerational challenges that the author tries to confront. The idea that kids should stay and take care of their parents is very much an Eastern culture thing, and I liked that Meddy wants to be independent, but she also has love and respect for her mother and aunts. There is never a point where Meddy wishes to belong to another culture or wants to give up her identity as an Indo-Chinese woman. I appreciated the end as well. Meddy moves out but still chooses to live close to her mom, and her mom visits her every day. That gives their relationship a realistic ending, as even though Meddy gets to enjoy her independence and has her personal space, her mother is still very much involved in her life. Another point that I enjoyed in the book was the subplot concerning Maureen and Jacqueline. Sutanto keeps us strategically hooked, as we can't fathom why Maureen would be so horrible to Jacqueline, only to reveal that Maureen wasn't bad after all, just in love with Jacqueline. I love that this book has LGBTQ representation without making a big deal out of the character's sexuality. Everyone is accepting of love in the novel and supportive of each other's decisions. Kudos to Sutanto for this. I have already been recommending Dial A for Aunties to friends. I was describing this book to a friend, and she was like, "Oh, is this a rom-com?" And while I hadn't thought of it as so before, I can totally see this as one. I can totally see this as the perfect summer or holiday movie as well. I can't wait for it to come on Netflix.
Yes, I would say it's a rom-com with a bit of an edge. Is there anything, Marzia, that you didn't like about the book?
Yes, my one piece of criticism would be that I got pretty tired of reading Nathan as this constant, flawless character who magically appears every single time Meddy is in distress. However, spoiler alert, this book isn't trying to be realistic, and it's supposed to be fun. So I see how Nathan's perfection fits the book. Still, I have conflicting feelings about it.
Yes, I agree. The only time Nathan was not perfect was when, spoiler alert, he saw part of the dead body in her bed and immediately thought she had lied and had a boyfriend that hadn't told him about.
Yeah. I'd have to agree about this point of the book. I really enjoyed most of the quirky and crazy mystery parts of this book, except for this little rom-com part. It did kind of feel like that was inserted at like kind of just like, oh, the author's like, oh, maybe you need something else on top of everything else. Yeah. I actually kept forgetting about Nathan sometimes, at least like in the present day parts, because, you know, it does go back and forth between, you know, it's like when she's in college and then mm-hmm. what she's doing now. And then even in those parts, I kept kind of forgetting that, oh, we also magically run into an ex-boyfriend who magically, you know, just happens to work at this hotel that they're hiding a dead body in. It just felt very just like, it added to the kookiness, but also it just kind of like, okay. Again, yeah, I agree, Marcia. Yeah. It was mixed feelings.
Yeah.
Mixed feelings about this one.
So Dial A for Aunties also has an unconventional writing style. What do you guys think? Did you enjoy it?
The writing style of going back and forth threw me at first, but I ended up liking it, and I felt it added a lot of depth and richness to this story. What could have been light and forgettable, like the love story we were mentioning, instead became a nuanced story about love and the importance of family with a bit of a twist thrown in to keep you guessing. I like how you guys talked about Nathan mm-hmm. and how he was kind of a side story, and really the importance of this book is about her family and mm-hmm. how they support her, and that made it really enjoyable.
Agree. Yeah, I did enjoy the writing style. It was a little confusing, I think, at first, but once you got used to it, it actually worked. I did like how kind of the first half is a bit like we're seeing a little bit like when I believe it's when, you know, Those are the times when Mehdi's off at college, and that's kind of the first time she's been away from her aunties. And we do see how hard it was for her to be away from her mom and her aunties. And we do get a little more backstory on her relationship with Nathan and everything. So at least it still kind of, you know, made sense. But still, but even like with this writing style, the pacing felt very much like a movie or a TV show. So I do understand like why I am very excited to see what it will be like on Netflix, because it already feels like a Netflix show,
yeah.
especially with all like the randomness and like, oh gosh, all the bits of drama. So it almost feels like it was kind of written to be a Netflix show. So it was interesting.
Yeah, I liked the structure of the writing. And like you said, it mm-hmm. did feel like a movie. I felt the beginning was organized and easy to follow. But I don't know if I would enjoy this writing style consistently. I don't know if Sutanto adopted an informal tone for this particular book, or if that's her writing style in its entirety. I'll guess I'll have to read another one of her novels and find out.
Yeah, and I will address that in a little bit, because I've read another one of her novels. And yes, you are correct on the style. Okay, this is Kristen in my review and thoughts. I really liked how close the family is and how much of a team the aunties are. I also thought the idea of a family curse was very interesting, and I loved that the aunties viewed it as a blessing rather than a curse, because it meant that they got to be close and spend so much time together after their husbands had left. The whole book highlights how close the family is and how supportive they are of each other. In fact, the whole story starts because her ma is trying to help Mehdi get a husband, so she tells everyone about her being single, then, spoiler alert, poses as her on a dating website and ends up getting catfished by an unsavory suitor. I also listened to the audio version of the book, and it adds even more humor and fun to the story than reading it did for me. The second half of the book reminds me a lot of the hilarious 1989 movie starring Andrew McCarthy and Jonathan Silverman entitled Weekend at Bernie's. If you haven't seen it, in the film, the two gentlemen had to convince hitmen that Bernie was still alive, so they dressed him up, carried him around, and even had him water ski without skis at one point. In the book, the scene where the dead character was a groomsman in the wedding and somehow fell in the water or was dropped felt very similar to the hijinks in the movie. So if you liked that movie, you might also enjoy this book. I also was able to get an early copy of the sequel to this book, which is Four Aunties and a Wedding. It will be published in March. This book highlights, spoiler alert, Mehdi and Nathan's wedding, which takes place in Oxford in England. This one does not involve an accidental murder like Dial A for Aunties, but does involve the mafia, kidnapping, and lots of wedding hijinks in which the aunties are once again fully involved. I preferred the first book to the sequel just because it seemed to have more humor and was more laugh-out-loud funny than the wedding book. I also thought Dial A for Aunties had more heart than the sequel does. However, I do think fans of the first book will enjoy this one very much, as it is a funny follow-up. And I think Marzi and Abby kind of brought up the point about this one as well. I think you two might enjoy this less because it is more about the romance and less about the aunties, even though they are involved because it's the wedding and it's all about the wedding, where the other one had a lot of other stuff and you kind of forgot about Nathan.
Yes.
If you are looking for a read-alike for this book or series, I would recommend Kevin Kwan's very popular series, The Crazy Rich Asians Trilogy. All of the books are full of rompy fun, love and angst, and above all, highlight the importance of family. The settings and wealth in both series are also fabulously fun to read about and a nice form of escapism.
And this is Abby again. Here's my little review of the book. So I really enjoyed this book. I finished it in about a week. It's a nice fast-paced book, but not too fast. It just kind of, it's one of those books that kind of keeps you hooked and you want to find out what craziness is going to happen next. And like, it has a little bit of everything. It's got mystery, lots of hijinks, and like, you know, an added romance and multiple added romances, like how you mentioned earlier. I thought there was, you know, yeah, between Maureen and Jacqueline. And I thought the writing style was interesting. And, you know, to follow up what I said earlier, it does feel like, you know, a TV show, especially with going on the back and forth between Mehdi's time in college and to the what's happening present day. I'm also just finding that a lot of new contemporary books are kind of written this way, that with the pace where it just feels like you can already feel this is going to, mm-hmm, could be a good TV show or movie. I don't know if like new contemporary writers are doing that on purpose. And if they are, good job. That's a good writing ploy. But I also loved the relationship that, you know, between Mehdi and her mother and aunts. And I love how she didn't, how determined she was not to abandon them after so many of their family members and, you know, and husbands had. Another thing why I liked, you know, seeing the flashbacks to her in college, we do see how hard it was for her to move away from all of them and how much she missed them and how she even felt bad for finding a nice guy. And I thought that was another thing that Sutanto crafted very well in this book. We really see the conflict that Mehdi has just within herself, how she wants to be there for her mom and aunts. You know, she doesn't want to move away, but then another part of her wants her independence, wants her own life and even her own career, you know, but she also feels bad about that. So it's like, I think Sutanto did a really great job of, you know, of crafting Mehdi's just almost like inner turmoil and everything else. And just how you really feel the pressure that Mehdi feels just to stay with them, but also just how she wants to just, you know, continue on with her life as well. But and I do like how at the end she seems to have kind of found a balance. So we'll see in the next book if she's able to maintain that this nice independence but family life balance. And so before we go, I would like to tell you all about our next read service. To participate, you just go to our website, fill out a short form to get 3 to 5 titles for a personalized book suggestion, or receive a library bundle, which is about 3 to 5 titles in your holds list. Check that out on our website today.
Let's meet again in March to discuss our next title, The Last Thing He Told Me, a riveting psychological thriller by Laura Dave.
Yes, I'm really excited to talk about that one. And one awesome thing about it is it's set partially in Austin, ooh, even on the UT campus. So it's really,
ooh, that's cool.
And it's a very cool, very cool read. We're excited to talk about that in March. And thanks everyone so much for listening today.